Let us pray. Holy God, mighty and immortal, you are beyond our knowing, yet we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. Transform us into the likeness of your Son, who renewed our humanity so that we may share in his divinity. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. For those of you gathered here, take a moment to share a wave or sign of peace. Those of you online, please put something in the chat or comments that shows peace. And most of all, as we go out into the world, let us greet all other people as people of peace.
Our first reading today is from Isaiah chapter 6, lines 1 through 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the thresholds shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed, and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go forth for us?" And I said, "Here I am, send me." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to stand for the reading of the gospel from Luke, the fifth chapter. It begins with, "But when Simon Peter saw it," Jesus is with Simon, and there he was fishing earlier in the day, and Jesus tells them to go back out into the water, to go catch some fish. And Simon said, "Lord, we've been doing it all night. We haven't caught anything." But they listened and went out, and they had so many fish that the nets began to break, and they had to call others to come help bring the catch. And this is Simon's response. "And when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, 'Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man.' For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And then Jesus said to Simon, 'Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people.'" The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Well, grace and peace to you from God and our Savior Jesus. Amen. Welcome to our first of a five-week series on Isaiah. And you might be thinking, what does Isaiah, a prophet from the 8th century BC, have to do with our life today in this world? And there is plenty. Because during these 5 weeks, we'll hear how God desires us to follow, to have faith, to be grateful, to find true comfort and true freedom. With today being the Sunday prior to Independence Day, we should probably work backwards and do the freedom part. However, that freedom is only made known as we hear the prophet share all that we should be doing to receive that freedom. Now, biblical prophecy has little to do with predicting the future. That is a misnomer in much. But what it does have is the ability to predict and remind us as people what we do. And 800 BC, some of these things, if you read the book of Isaiah, you'll go, that's happening here and now. And so it has a word for us. And God knows us better than we know ourselves. That's why the word is so important to read and reflect on. And it starts with this question. How many of us have made a decision in life knowing it was the wrong decision? Few hands, more smiles. Well, I drove through Duluth to get to our graduate sailing trip, and then I had to go back up to help my wife with the cabin this weekend going by Duluth, and it made me remember my days of running marathons. And early on, it was just to finish the marathon. And the best way to do that is to have people that you run alongside with. And so one of the people that I had the privilege to run with, she was a court stenographer. And as you're running along, you share stories to forget about all the miles that you have yet to accomplish. And she had the best stories. The one in particular, talking about a decision that you make that you knew was wrong from the beginning, there was a woman who had had a one-night stand after her graduation and ended up becoming pregnant, but didn't want the man to know that she had a child. And so she raised this child on her own. And the daughter always wondered who her dad was and asked the mom, you know what, for my graduation, I want to meet my dad. And the mom thought about it and then surprised her. She tracked him down. He was surprised to find out he had a child. But it was an amazing reunion, and it was a fabulous day of graduation. So why does a court stenographer know this story? Well, because that woman and that man were now in court deciding on having a custody battle because lightning struck twice. And on their daughter's graduation, they conceived another child. And this time, the man knew it and wanted to be a part of it. She had lots of stories. So how many times have you made a decision in your life knowing that it was the wrong decision, and then you repeated it again? We meet Isaiah in chapter 6. The first five chapters are a prologue about the vision Isaiah saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem, but more importantly, how he saw the people of God. Isaiah, like most people, did not desire to be called by God. He didn't think he was worthy, as we hear him declare, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." And what happens next? Hearing his declaration of confession, the seraph, one of the beings that were on next to the throne of God, takes a live coal from the altar and puts it on Isaiah's lips. And then we hear, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed, your sin is blotted out." It was after this that the Lord asked, "Whom shall I send, and whom will go for us?" And Isaiah responded, "Here I am, send me." I love to tell the story. Is a podcast out of Luther Seminary, and the episode that I was listening to, Professor Joy Moore of Biblical Preaching and Catherine Schiffendecker of Old Testament interviewed Dr. Corey Driver, assistant to the bishop in the Missouri Synod, not the denomination. And he's an adjunct professor at Luther Seminary where he's revising yet another website that they have called enterthebible.org. And they give a summary of the prescribed four-week series for Isaiah. And I extended it to 5 weeks because, lo and behold, Lake Wapagasset Bible Camp is using a text from Isaiah for their theme verse. And so putting that right in the middle to fill out the month of July. Like many commentators, they also agree that Isaiah is like the fifth gospel in the Bible. So many verses from Isaiah are quoted in the gospel readings. And Isaiah is a book of death and resurrection with lots of texts related to Christian hope. And in reading it, we get to see the kingdom of Judah. We get to see the Messiah as proclaimed. And we get to see ourselves in that reading. And what do we see in each of those? The overarching theme of Isaiah's prophecy is joy. Who doesn't need a little more joy in their life? As Christians, that's the way Jesus lived his life, in joy. And first century Jews saw the embodiment of Isaiah's prophecies in him. Dr. Driver views Isaiah's prophecies as a tenuous relationship between God and humanity. God is asking, "How are you, my people, missing me?" And the people, in response, say, "God, how are you missing us?" As people, we tend to be pretty self-centered. We see things through our own eyes and think things are about ourselves. And this prophecy is not. This prophecy is about a very small country, kind of like Guatemala, and it's surrounded by these larger empires that cause trouble and that God uses to punish the Israelites. This one and only God had a problem with his people. Ironically, to solve that problem, he gathered his people. That is how God works. From the garden to Jonah, from Noah to Abraham, God continually invites humans to be a part of the solution. Because God created us out of joy and love and wants us to live in that manner in our lives and to share that with others. So regardless if we are not faithful, believe ourselves to be inadequate, and have trouble caring for and loving God's creation, including loving our neighbors, God still invites us and asks, whom shall I send? Who will go for us? How many of us are willing to respond like Isaiah did? Here I am, send me. Too many church members just keep sitting in the stands, or we call them pews. And instead of stepping out onto the field, we are called to put our faith into action in the world. I would encourage you to read Isaiah during this month of July. It's 66 chapters, about 2.5 chapters a day as you walk through the entire book. Add it to your summer reading list. And from it, as Dr. Driver points out, the book of Isaiah depicts God's judgment for injustice and idolatry, but also God's restoration and redemption, announced and enacted by God's chosen servant. If we have eyes to see and ears to hear, it invites us to take honest reflection of our own life. We can see that Isaiah is the story of a community that's just way too content. When it is confronted with God's negative evaluation, it echoes back, really, us? We must notice the framing of Isaiah's mission. He was to make the people insensitive to God's word so that they could be driven to judgment rather than repentance. Isaiah and God are on the same page. There is a national problem that will require a national level of repentance to solve. However, it seems to be too late. Punishment is coming, but also healing. It would mean that the community would have to wake up to exactly how bad the problem is. Our gospel reading, Jesus is calling his disciples. They too recognize the danger of imperfection when the Lord called. Nevertheless, God and Jesus are less reluctant to use imperfect humans as partners than imperfect humans are to imagine that God would want to collaborate with them. But that's exactly what God wants in the calling of Isaiah and the calling of the disciples. I was reminded of this truth. God does not call the equipped. God equips the called. So no matter your imperfections, no matter how you feel, I can't do that, God says, yes, you can, and I will help you. For 100 years, St. Luke's has been offering this invitation. We heard it from Pastor Talene Saunders last week in her message. She was a child of St. Luke's who was welcomed and grew in faith in this community and now is busy making Christ known to the world. God is using her, and God invites you to be a part of God's plan for this world, the redemption and restoration and salvation that God offers. Now, not all of us are called to be pastors. But I see it at work here in the calling of our hearts, of what we desire to do to make this world a better place. As I said, here I am, send me to feed God's starving children, delivering meals on wheels, sharing our food and our household supplies with Veep to care for our community, using thread and cloth and yarn to make quilts, hats, scarves, and prayer shawls to offer warmth and comfort. We use our gifts to sing praises and read scripture and run sound and video and cameras and welcome people into worship as ushers, greeters, and treat providers to set the table to enjoy our meal. And I had the privilege to work alongside a dozen of our members during the best week of the summer at VBS. In all of these ways, we are declaring, here I am, send me. And God equips us to do all of this, not with a live coal, but with the bread and wine that's at the altar, the body and blood of Jesus touching our lips, cleansing us. Our guilt is departed, and our sin is blotted out, and we are free. Our faith strengthened with grateful hearts, comforted with true freedom, and experiencing joy, God's joy and steadfast love that we are told endures forever, so that we can be sent out into this world that so desperately needs to know and receive it. In Jesus' name, amen. I invite us to stand and sing, "Open the Eyes of My Heart."
And as one who got equipped, I invite you to join me in professing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. he descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Called by the Holy Spirit into relationship with a loving God, we pray for the church, all in need, and the whole creation. God of glory and grace, you answer those who call your name. Continue the transformation of your church so that we may share your love with the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let the mountains and valleys that you created be places of worship. Help us to treat your good creation with the respect that it deserves. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let the rulers of the earth honor your decrees and uphold your statutes so that your peace would reign throughout the earth. Give mercy to the poor and justice to the weak. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heal the sick, comfort the grieving, send peace to the dying and companionship to those in prison, whether the prison is one for correction or one built of human loneliness. Be with all who suffer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You spoke to Israel in a pillar of cloud. Speak to this community of faith so that we might be a place of refuge and help for our neighbors. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, keep us in your care until we gather with all the saints from every time and every place in the company of our sovereign God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your loving hands, gracious God, we place ourselves and all our prayers, spoken and unspoken, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Not with a live coal, but with bread and wine. And we, like Isaiah, cry out, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a person of unclean lips and live among a people of unclean lips. Lord, go away from me, for I am a sinful person." But Jesus says, "Come." I encourage you to take a moment of silent reflection. Lord, we give thanks for your life, your love, and your salvation, made known in this simple meal of bread and wine that is your body and blood. On the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, he gave thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and after giving thanks, gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. Take and drink. Do this in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we share the body and blood of our Lord and Savior who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. We thank you, O God, that you have fed us at your banqueting table with bread and wine beyond compare, the very life of Christ for us. Send your Spirit with us now, that we may set the captive free, use our gifts to build one another up, and in everything reflect your glory revealed in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Gracious and merciful to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Now go in peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.